Hey everyone, and welcome back. Well, yep, it's me, it's Rick, and I'm on the other side of the camera this time. Yep, feeling a little bit uncomfortable about that, not my normal place. But I thought it might be useful just to kind of give a short introduction with a human face, because what I did do in this project is started out kind of dabbling around in the digital dark side. Yep, I started playing around with a little bit of artificial intelligence, specifically ChatGPT. Okay, why did I do that? Well, I thought, you know, let's see, I had some components. I had some, you know, the model, I had a few ideas in my head, what the theme of this layout, this kit might end up being. And so rather than scratch my head and look through reference photographs online and things like I would normally do, I thought, what if I just put a few keywords into ChatGPT and see what it gave me? And whatever that might be, that would be the theme that I would follow. So, and that is exactly what I did. So in just a few moments, I'll show you the keywords that I put in the prompts. And then within about 10 seconds, I got a very nice narrative, about 4 or 5 paragraph narrative, could be the introduction to a movie, description of the layout of the scene, basically a narrative, like I said, very descriptive, very, it's very nice. But the bottom line is that I'm using that narrative in order to guide myself through this project here. So the basic project is we have a burnt out T34. It's the old MIG Productions resin kit. It's a great classic kit. We'll see that in just a minute. Burn that out. We'll put it into a field with the farmer. So that'll be basically the concept of this theme here. So a lot of traditional modeling yet to come, plenty of that, but an introduction here through our friends at Artificial Intelligence. I hope you enjoy the rest of the video. Take care, guys. And so the basic premise here is I had the T34, and that was going to be the centerpiece of this scene. But what I did not want to do was the typical, you know, burned out T34 with the Russian soldiers nearby, or maybe some German soldiers looking into it. I wanted to do something a little bit different. And that's when the idea of, well, let's ask AI to come up with an idea for this. And so I typed in some prompt words, write an introduction of a Russian farmer, 1946, so post-war, a destroyed T-34 hull. And like I said, after just, you know, 10 seconds or so, I ended up with this. As the sun slowly rose over the rolling hills of rural Russia, casting a warm golden glow upon the land, a scene of perseverance and resilience unfolded in the year 1946. In a vast field, where once the echoes of thunderous artillery and the roar of tanks dominated the air, a lone Russian farmer toiled amidst the remnants of a brutal war that had ravaged the land. With weathered hands and a face etched with the marks of hardship, the farmer, Nikolai, stood tall, his gaze fixed upon the horizon around him. The earth bore witness to the scars of conflict. Amongst the ruins, a stark reminder of the recent past stood silently, the skeletal remains of a T-34 tank, its mighty form reduced to a shattered hull. As Nikolai plowed the fertile soil, the sight of the broken war machine served as a constant reminder of the sacrifices made by his countrymen. The war had been a merciless storm that swept across the nation, leaving destruction and despair in its wake. Yet here, amongst the remnants of battle, life persevered. The fields were being tended, nurturing the promise of a bountiful harvest to sustain a nation in recovery. The echoes of the past mingled with the present as Nikolai worked diligently, his hands working the rich soil. The rumble of tanks had given way to the symphony of nature, with the gentle rustle of leaves and the chirping of birds serving as a soothing backdrop. It is a world reclaiming its tranquility, slowly healing from the wounds of war. Well, I think you admit that's quite the prose there, something that I probably wouldn't have written for myself. But that's the jumping off spot for this project here. So we're going to follow that idea, that narrative, and produce a scene with a burnt out or destroyed T-34, the year 1946, and a farmer working in his field. Okay, so now we can leave the digital AI stuff behind and get back into analog modeling. So our centerpiece on this project is going to be this, I'd even call it a classic, this knocked out T-34. This is a very early release from MIG Productions, the early 2000s. It's a full resin kit, as you can see here. We've got our cast resin parts all in the little baggie there, so everything stays in one place and doesn't fall out and get lost during transit. And then the instruction booklet is classic resin kit type of an instruction, where you basically have photographs of the parts. The parts are laid out, they're numbered on the page, and then basically some sequential build photographs showing where the parts are and kind of the buildup of the model itself. And then as a bonus here on the rear side, we do have a bit of a painting index here, a little suggestion on how to recreate the the style and the look that was on the box art. So that's kind of nice and fun and handy as well. Again, a classic kit and a classic presentation. When working with resin kits, there are a few different rules and a few different things that we need to take care of or be at least aware of here. And the first is, of course, we don't have our general sprues like we would in, say, a styrene type kit. We have basically casting blocks. And as such, these pieces or parts for the model need to be separated from the casting blocks. And that's generally fairly easy to do, especially on good casts, in that there's the blocks themselves are fairly thin and they can be separated. The parts can be separated from the excess resin. One of the things, if you work on resin kits, especially with multiple parts like this, you'll notice that there's different types of excess material that needs to be removed. And that's basically dependent upon the part. And the parts kind of indicate or determine what type of a mold is used to create each individual part. So in some cases, there's very little excess material, but in other cases such as this, where it's a larger part, you know, a much more substantial casting block there that a razor saw will help cut through that and can just break that off and then file it back to smooth it out. Any excess material is basically cleaned up the same way as you would with a styrene or plastic part. You can use a sanding stick or files or sandpaper or something like that. Resin powder is not great for you, so if you're hesitant, you know, use a mask or something like that to protect you for the particulates, you know, breathing those in. And then the other, of course, big change from plastic parts to resin parts is that we'll be using super glue to glue everything together rather than plastic cement because, well, plastic cement will just not work. Now, doing a little dry fitting, a little test fitting on any kit is always a good idea. It's especially a good idea when working with resin kits because, well, the process in of itself, casting and molding the parts and such, there's a little bit of inaccuracies in there at some points and times. Molds wear out. There's a little bit of, you know, deviation here and there. And resin itself is somewhat susceptible or more susceptible to warping. And so a little extra time doing some test fitting is always a great idea. You can always sand back the parts a little bit if they don't quite match up directly. In this case, the kit, it's actually fitting together fantastic. So they've done a great job of molding and preserving the masters on this one. There are a few areas that I'm going to add just a few extra details here, and I'll just do that with styrene. Once again, we have to glue the styrene in using super glue. Really easy. You can do as much or a little of this as you want. And now it's time to get down to painting here. So once again, resin kits, incredibly important to put a layer of primer, in this case, Mr. Surfacer 1200 sprayed over all. And now for the painting. And this will take up the rest of this video. We're gonna paint this model and get it ready for the centerpiece on this field. Now, of course, the basic idea, the basic theme here is that we have a T34 that's been knocked out probably for a few years. So it's been sitting here in this field. So it's not gonna have, you know, ash or fresh burn marks or anything like that. It's going to be a more rusted type Hulk sort of thing. First thing I want to do is just put a dark layer down. That's with the black color. And then I'm going to be just using hairspray. We're going to do quite a few layers of chipping and hairspray on this as we build up the colors, remove some of the colors in order to give us a really nice foundation with which to kind of show off and showcase all this wear and tear on this model here. So the basic process here for painting and weathering this out is actually very, very simple. So it's just a layer of color followed by a layer of hairspray. Let that dry, another layer of color, another layer of hairspray, and we'll keep repeating that. So the layers of color, they'll be in different, you know, different colors, yes, but also different densities. So sometimes they're very light and sometimes they're very, you know, more heavily applied. So this will give us a kind of a random chipping pattern, and that's what I'm looking for because this is going to create basically our roadmap to do some further weathering as we move further on in the process here. And then finally, well, we've gotten to that point where I feel like it's time to start peeking underneath the covers here and see what we have. So I have a brush, of course, and it's moistened with water, and I'm just applying some water over the top of the paint here, and this, of course, will activate the hairspray underneath, and we can start peeling off these layers or chipping through these layers. Now, as I mentioned, I'm trying to develop a roadmap here, or just a real interesting patina of colors that I'll be accentuating a little bit later on. We're not really necessarily trying to get back to, say, a base color or wear off a winter whitewash. That's not my goal here at all. My goal here is basically take all these colors, chip them to various degrees, to various levels, and then we'll come back and we could see, oh, we've got some bright spots, we've got some dark spots, we have some rusty colors, we have some darker colors here and there, and then we'll be able to start to accentuate those. My friends, this channel lives in the real world, and as such, it thrives off the support of my Patreon, and those are the names that you see scrolling across the screen at the moment. It is through their support this channel is made possible. If you like this channel and the content, please consider joining Patreon and helping to support this channel. In return, made for Patreon videos, work in progress photographs, a Discord to show off our works and have chats. I hope to see you over there and I hope to see your support on this channel. Thank you. So you probably have noticed that after all this chipping, this model looks pretty blasé. It's bland. There's not a lot of definition, not a lot of color here. And that's where this next step comes in. So we're going to switch off to acrylic paints here. Now we have a roadmap. We have got all these different textures and little color pops and flakes here and there. And now we can come back with our acrylic paints with a nice brush and start expanding some of those fields, bringing out some of the colors here and there, changing some details even here and there, adding some color. It's, you know, there's no rules to this at all. Just kind of what's in your head and start bringing it out. Again, this is going to look a little bit random and kind of chaotic here for a little while, but it will all kind of pull together at the very end. Again, we're using the roadmap from developed through the chipping to kind of guide this next process here. You also might notice that I'm not being very shy here with the colors. You know, the vibrancy of this yellow, for instance, it kind of looks a little out of place at this stage, but that's okay because, again, we're trying to regain some of that contrast, some of that interest that we lost through the chipping process. And so if I was to say, summarize this, you know, the chipping process, that whole chipping thing, that gave us the roadmap with which now to paint over the top of. So now we've got a almost like a basically a paint by numbers here. So we can bring out these different colors that we have revealed through the chipping process and start working to accentuate those and balance those back out. It's starting to come together nicely, tell you the truth. We could stop here. I could stop here, and I think it would be, I'd be very pleased with it. It looks great. It's basically got the patina, the coloring that I want, that I have in my head. Maybe it's a little bright, but what I really want to do now, I think I can really accentuate the depth of the finish here, give it a little bit more aging. And of course, you knew we would do it at some point in time. We're going to pull out the oil paints. This is that time where I'm at a big loss of words of what, trying to describe what it is I'm trying to do with the oil paints. I'm not trying to change the colors at all. Well, I am. But what I'm trying to do more than anything is just kind of harmonize things here. Maybe that's the right word, harmonize. So we have these hot spots. The acrylic paints, just by the nature of acrylics, they make everything, you know, very vibrant and sharp. The oil paints, we can come back in over the top of the acrylics here and just kind of soften this up a little bit. I think that's going to go a long ways to helping convey the appearance of a T34 that's been sitting around for a little while and aging in the field here for a few years. As you may imagine, that adding layer upon layer of paint and hairspray and then waiting for everything to dry and then chipping it off and then reapplying colors and then applying oils and all the rest of it, well, you saw the video, you know what we just did. it's taken a little bit of time to get to this point, which means that we're coming to the conclusion of this episode. This is where we stand at the moment. Of course, coming up, we have a narrative to follow, and that is to set a scene here. So we're going to put this T-34 into some sort of a field in Russia. We'll pull out some sort of a farmer here at some point in time. So that's all coming up in future videos as we start to pull this all together. And now, yeah, a big sigh. What do you guys think of AI? What do you think of using digital tools such as that in our hobby? I'm curious. Put it in the comments. I think this is a discussion that we can have, how these types of new tools might fit into our hobby in the future. In this case, I just used ChatGPT to come up with a narrative, basically, you know, help solidify my ideas, maybe what was already in my head. And I don't really see it as much different than simply looking through Google Images to kind of reference some photographs. But of course, there are other AI programs out there, Midjourney being one of them, that can do renderings of scenes, you know, visuals, images, and things like that. So is that a future that we might want to look into? Come up with those same keywords, have it display a scene, and then model that scene based on that image that it generates. I don't know. It's a new world out there. Somehow we're going to be involved in it. I'm not sure exactly how, but I kind of enjoy dipping my toe in there to see where it goes and what I can do with it. So, as I said, this is the end of this one here. In the next one, we'll really dive into making the base and the scene and painting a figure and such. So until the next time, guys, take care and happy modeling.